Daddy, what's wrong? Super Bear's all tore up again. His ear's coming off. His clothes are torn. He's got a hole in his cape. I don't know if I can fix him this time, buddy. He's just really too tore up. Do you want me to try and fix him? Or do you want me to get you a new one? A new toy? What would you like? Oh, okay. I'll get you a new toy. All right. Oh, all right.
What I'm thinking about doing is a toy that I remember from my childhood. It was a little stuffed dog. It had kind of a roundish, oval-shaped head, and it was a girl. It was a girl dog. Her name was Frisky, and she was just really simply made. Put an arm there. Leg there. And another leg there. She didn't have a tail. But I remember she had like a brown head and a white face. Remember what her nose looked like, so I'm just gonna put a scribble right there for now. I'm gonna erase all these extra lines here. Okay. I remember her eyes. Were brown, and they had these little cloth eyelashes. Draw that in. Like, my pen won't write. Let me get a better pen. It's my little grab it bag of art supplies. Oh, while I have you here, while I have this open, I'll go ahead and show you what I have in here. This is my little travel watercolor kit. All these different colors in this little spot here where you can mix up your paint. My little pencil sharpener. I usually carry two different pencils in my kit. This one's an HB. And this one is a 2H. So I have kind of like a hard pencil and a soft pencil. And then finally I have a white watercolor crayon for like putting in highlights and stuff. This one is a Microperm 0801 by Sakura. It's got a little bit of paint on it. I was using it in an earlier project. So Frisky kind of had these pointy black eyelashes. I remember that. Color in these eyelashes. Her head and her body were brown. I remember when I was a little girl, this little doll was one of my favorite toys. And when I grew older, I took a dress off of one of my dolls. It was like a little white lace dress. And then I put that dress on Frisky. And then I gave her to my brother. He was younger than I was. He remembers it to this day as me presenting Frisky to him. So there's her little white head. Or her little brown head, rather. Incidentally, I'm using this marker paper. I've never used it before. It's supposed to be bleed-proof. Let's see. Well, it bled through, but it's not wet. I can't remember the nose. I'm gonna just put it in black. Let's see if I have a black marker in my kit. It was just a little black, you know, I think it was sewn on or it was a puffball, I can't remember. But I remember it wasn't hard, it was a soft nose. And I remember her eyes were brown. Little black pupils. Oops, my hand. I'll do the pupils with this pen. My brother still has this Frisky. He's moved around a whole lot. He's in the Navy. But he always packs Frisky. And he keeps her someplace in his house. I love these Copic markers that have the little brush tip on them. There's actually two tips. There's that one. And then there's this chisel tip. I always use the brush tip. So I bought extra tips because I know I'm going to wear them out. All right. No, I'm no stuffed animal making expert. This is like the second one I've ever done in my life. The first one was when I was in the seventh grade. And I think a friend of mine gave me a kit. And it was a do-it-yourself stuffed animal kit where you make your own Siamese cat was what my kit was. And I remember, like, we had the pattern that had all the different pattern pieces drawn on it. And then the kit had flat, you know, the material. And you had to, you know, cut out the material according to the pattern. And this was the first time I'd ever really, you know, sewed anything besides just playing around with my mom's sewing machine. And so I followed the directions in the kit, and lo and behold, you know, I made this very crude Siamese cat. And I was like, you know, my mind was blown by firsthand demonstration of taking a two-dimensional object like, you know, cloth and creating a three-dimensional thing out of it. When I was little, my mind, that just blew my mind that that could be done. This is going to be a very crude design. What I'm trying to do is, I'm trying to recall what this toy looked like. I remember the outside of the ears were white, but the inside of the ears were pink. So I kind of drew the other ear right there. It's a pink ear. And just to give her head some definition, I'm just going to use this light gray marker to just put shading on her head. And then some shading on this ear. Just so it shows up on camera, I'm gonna color her head in, her face in a little bit with this gray marker instead of leaving it white, just so you get, you know, some idea of what she looked like. So she looked somewhat like that. That was the edge of her ear. There. So this is close to what she looked like. No tail, just real simple limbs. Can't remember the nose. Inside of her ear pink, outside white, face white, eyes brown, little black eyelashes, and the rest of the body brown. So this is what I'm going to attempt to make. Here is the material that I'll be making our toy with. Get my sketch. This is like a really cheap, soft, fake fur that I got at the fabric store. I went to Joann's. And this fake fur has two sides. It has one side with like a short fuzzy nap. And then the other side, the nap is a little bit longer. So I think for this toy, I'm going to have the longer fur on the outside. It looks, if I compare the two sides, the longer side looks closer to what I remember. Here is almost the same kind of material, but in white. There's a long nap side on one side. And the other side really doesn't have any kind of nap. It's just really, really short. But it's really soft and fuzzy. And this is what I'm going to use to make the ears and the face. Here's a piece of black felt. And this is gonna be those little eyelashes that I remember. Here is some pink material that this will be the inside of Frisky's ears. I'm not sure what this material is called. It's shiny on one side, like satiny, and then the other side is not as shiny. Also at the craft store, I bought a bag of pom-poms. I needed something for Frisky's nose. And you can't just walk into the craft store and buy one pom-pom. They make you buy like 1,000. So I don't know what I'm going to do with all these pom-poms. Oh my goodness. Who uses this many pom-poms? Honestly. I just need one. And I'm thinking Frisky's nose will probably be one of the black ones. I don't really imagine it, right? Don't judge. But I just don't know what size black one. So I'm just going to set these aside and we'll put the nose on last. I'll have a better idea which one I use. And I might change my mind. I might use, you know, one of the brown ones. One of the yellow ones. Who knows? All of these pom-poms give me options. And then finally, these right here are the best part. Little eyeballs. And they're brown. And here's the little backings. I found these at the craft store and I jumped on them. They're perfect. I don't know how this drawing is going to show up on video, so I'm going to color in the background for anybody who can't see. Okay, there we go. That's Frisky against a blue. I'm gonna put this on my refrigerator. All right, the first thing that I'm going to do is take this muslin right here, and I'm going to use this muslin to create a pattern to make this. So I've got yards and yards of muslin. I used it in my tailoring video that I made a few months back. Let's see. Now I'm gonna need something to drape this fabric on. What I'm thinking is using this grapefruit as the three-dimensional dummy for Frisky's head. Now this grapefruit is a little big, so I'll have to make adjustments to the pattern after I drape it. So to do this, I don't need this whole thing. I'm gonna cut, let's see. There's a nice round spot. I'm gonna cut it right about here. Now what I'm going to do is cut a piece of muslin just big enough to go around the grapefruit. This grapefruit is going to be the back of Frisky's head, because if you notice, her head is kind of egg-shaped. It's bigger in the back than it is in the front. This will all make sense when we finish doing what we need to do. Okay, so what we're going to do is I'm just going to anchor the muslin onto the grapefruit on one side, about like that, and that just keeps it in place. Let's put a couple anchor pins in the middle. All right, now I want to create folds in four spots on this piece of fabric. So we'll just go ahead and start right over here. Let me turn this. So let's see. We'll just anchor this. this in a few more spots. And anchor it back here. Okay. So we'll work with this little corner right here. So what we're going to do is gather up this bit of material right here, and we're going to pin it closed. And one more should do it. All right, that's one corner. Let's do this corner directly across from it, so we make sure our seams line up. If it's not perfect, I don't think Jack will complain too much. And another pin right over here. Right. Now let's put a fold in on these sides here. Let's see, how about, let's loosen this up a little bit. How about right over here? Basically, what I'm doing is the same basic concept as it applies to creating clothing for a person. But if you have a person, then ordinarily you would have a dress form. Yep, that's Jack. Bless you, Jack. You okay, buddy? I'm working on your toy as fast as I can. All right. Oh, he wants it now. Like I was saying, same basic concept as when you are draping an outfit for a human person. You use a dress form to help you make your three-dimensional pattern. I don't have a form for a stuffed toy, so I'm gonna have to use fruit or whatever I have in my fridge. Right. Now, if you notice, we're getting some crazy bunched up fabric here. Not a problem. We will simply fix that. All right. One more. All right. Anchor it down. Okay, this is more or less the back of Frisky's head. So what I want to do now is take a marker and I'm going to draw my darts. These things that I made here are called darts. And we'll draw around the outside of the head. And be sure you get both sides of the dart. Both sides are important. Draw around the head. Do the dart here. There, Draw around the head. Sketch it down over here. And finally, the last side. All right. So now I'm going to cut off the excess material. Then we pull out our pins and we see what kind of mess we made. Okay, I'm done with the grapefruit for now, so we'll set it aside. All right. What we're looking at here is basically what we need to create if we cut along these lines that I drew, and then we sew them together all the way around, you'll end up with a three-dimensional shape. But, as you can see, this outline needs a little cleaning up. So I'm just gonna draw in the lines. Like that. Now to make the head roundish, these lines that I drew here, they're really not supposed to be straight. They need to come in at a very, very slight curve, and this will help give us our gently sloping, rounded form. So I'm just going to bring them in a little bit. See, this is a little uneven, so I'm going to bring this in this way. And basically, you just kind of want to eyeball it and make sure that all your arms are kind of, you know, even somewhat. One more. Let's fix this arm. All right. Now I need to establish my my center point, and really I should have done that when I still had the material on the grapefruit. So I'm just going to take a guess, and we'll call this the center. Okay, so now what we do is we're going to cut out our pattern. The great thing about using muslin is you can experiment with it, and if you make a mistake, it's no big loss. It's a lot better to practice on muslin than it is to practice on your actual material, because muslin is really, really cheap. I literally have yards and yards of it, because it comes in handy for so many things. First, we're going to start by just cutting all around. All right. Now let's cut out our little arms. All right. I have fixed the pattern by cutting out a new one. Here's the old one right here. This one, when I sewed it together, it kind of made a shape that was a little too conical for me. So I modified it. And I did test this in my sewing machine. That's why you see these little threads here. Because I test sewed it together, and it made a nice rounded dome for the back of Frisky's head. And as a comparison, here's the old one that I did, and we'll compare it to the new one, to the fixed one. So you see how much of an angle difference it makes if you want a more rounded shape. So we probably won't be using this pattern piece. And I actually made two pieces like this, because I'm going to take this piece and I'm going to modify it further. And this piece will be the front of the head or the face. It doesn't really matter which side we pin this template on, because each arm should be identical all the way around. I used this tool here, my little calipers, and I also used a tape measure and a French curve, and that's how I got this. Right, so what we're gonna do is pin this down. About like that. I'll start by pinning the outside of the arms. And you wanna be careful when you pin this onto the fabric. You don't want to like stretch it and pull it this way and that way. You want it to lay as flat as possible. So that's why I'm padding it. Now, the reason why I cut the material further from the arms is because when I made this template, I cut it out precisely to the actual size of the head that I want, but I didn't allow myself any seam allowance to put it through the sewing machine. So that's what I'm going to do now, is cut it in such a way that I add seam allowance to it, and that'll give me room to sew. I'm going to give it about a half inch seam allowance. So that's going to look like about like that. It's not going to be exact. I'm going to eyeball it. Alright, there we go. And this will be the back of Frisky's head. So I'm going to go ahead and sew this up, and then we'll base the face off of how the back of the head turns out. I'm just winging this, guys. I can tell that when I make the snoot, I'm going to have to make it from a longer template. Like, this part needs to come out longer. All right. Now I'm going to measure maybe like an inch or two further out. So I need to get my little ruler, my little caliper thing. I think 2 inches might be a bit much. Well, no, I have to take into account my seam allowance, okay. Maybe I should make it 1.5. Yeah, 1.5. And then I'll just mark. And you know, if this doesn't turn out perfectly, then I'm not going to be that stressed, because I doubt very much Jack will care whether or not it's perfect, that is. He'll just be happy to get a new toy. He's always happy to get a new toy. I'm going to make the ears 2 inches wide at the base at this part here, which means if I add a half inch seam allowance on either side of the ears, that'll be a total of 3 inches at the base. And how long should I make? I think the ear should be 6 inches long, so 7 inches, so 3 by 7. All right, I've got a scrap piece of muslin here, and I'm going to start by drawing a straight line. Just like that. And I'm going to divide this line. Oops, let's make this line a little bit longer. Alright, then I'm going to make a center line right down the middle. Alright. Now, what did I say I wanted my ear to be? I think 3 inches total, is that right? Yeah, 3 inches at the top. So what I'm going to do is measure 1.5 inches from this center line, this point right here. So 1.5 inches should put me right about here. Okay. Then I wanted the ears to be 7 inches long. Actually, 6 inches plus a 1 inch seam allowance for the top and the bottom. Now, to make sure my ears are even, what I'm gonna do is fold this piece of material in half. Just like so, right down that center red line. Just like that. I'm going to extend my measurements right there. Okay. Now to make sure this stays in half, I'm going to just kind of pin it. Now let's see, how do I kind of want the ears to be like a almost a teardrop shape. So let's see, I'm gonna freehand this. All right, here we go. Let's have it come out to about here. Go. Now let's cut this out and see what it looks like. And that is my template for one ear. So now I'm going to go ahead and cut out two of these. All right, there we go. Two ears. Now remember, we also need the inside of the ear, this pink part right there. So I need to take this template and cut out two pieces of my pink material. So what I need to do is pin the right sides together, which is this one and this one. All right. There's both ears pinned, and now I'm going to sew these pieces together. So I'm going to move the camera so you get a better angle. That's the top of the head, then it goes like that. That means I have to attach it right here. And this backing is for the eyelashes. Right there. So, to do that, what I'm going to do is cut out some little squares that these would fit in. About like that. And then I'm going to poke a hole in the middle with my little seam ripper. Just like that. Then kind of just work it around until it's about that big. You really don't want to make them too big. I'll do the same thing with the other one. Okay. Then you put each eyeball through. Need to make this a little bit bigger. Going to kind of free form the little black ring around the eyes and make the eyelashes. Now, I need to mark my spots where I want the eyeballs to go. So, I'm thinking right here and right here. This is where I'm going to pierce the material. There. There. Mark where I'm going to pierce. This reminds me when I was a little kid. My mom took me to the mall to get my ears pierced. And I remember the lady who did it, she would mark a little dot on my earlobe. And then she put the gun up to my ear, the little piercing gun, and I remember it hurt. There we go. Let's make sure they're big enough for the posts to go through. Okay. Then you put squeeze it down really good. There. Then we fix the eyelashes a little bit. And just push the polyfill through the neck hole. Notice here how Frisky's body is kind of eggplant shaped. That's why I got an eggplant. So it kind of look about like that. So I'm gonna use this eggplant the same way I used the grapefruit earlier to drape this muslin over the grapefruit, pin it down, and draw a pattern from that. Let's cut the stem off. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to go put this other piece of eggplant in the fridge because I'm going to fry it up for later. I'll be right back. Let me drape our patient. Okay. Then we just start pinning it. Let's start from the middle. This is really not a exactly symmetrical eggplant, but that's okay. We can true it up after we pin it. And then you want to pin the dart so that it follows the contour of the eggplant. Okay, let's mark it up. All right, let's unpin it and see what we ended up with. Because right now it's gonna be as big a surprise to me as it is to you. Okay. So let me kind of true this up. And then draw a line across the top. I think, given the size of Frisky's head, I'm gonna add an extra 1.5 inches all the way around because I think for this body to be in proportion with this head, it needs to be a little bit bigger, just a smidge. So we're gonna go 1.5, about right there, 1.5 there, 1.5 there, okay. Then we just go straight across. Right. Now I'm gonna try and find, I think the center point would be this point right here. So if I were to make this line perpendicular, it'd be like about like that. Then I'm just gonna kind of loosely sketch, connect the dots. something about this neck edge because it has to match up with this, the width of this part right here. So I'm glad I thought of that now before I started sewing. Here's my template for the back of the head. Okay, I'm going to sew this part and this part, and you guys have already seen me operate a sewing machine, so I'm going to do that off camera so I don't have to reset my camera and my mic, and I'll be right back. Okay, here's the back. You can kind of see the little bump right there. I had to recut the front and leave out that little little divot, the little dart to make the front, because when I sewed both of these together, it looked ridiculous to have the bump on both the front and the back. So I just made it without the bump. Grab my trusty old muslin again. I'm just gonna reuse this old piece. Straight line. Line down the middle, 1 3/4 inches. Then I need to go down 9 inches. Now for these paws. If we go this length here, I kind of want to have them flare out a little bit because I think it looks cute. Have them flare out to about right there. All right. Now, obviously, these aren't going to be square paws, so I'm going to round this corner. Follow that curve. Just like that. There we go. And that's our template for our paws. Now I need to cut actually 8 pieces of this out of the brown fur, because each limb is going to have 2 pieces front and back, and there's 4 limbs, that makes 8. Here's my stack of paws. And let's just whip these through the machine. What I'm doing is putting a tacking stitch at the beginning where the stress points are, so that when Jack pulls on the limbs, as he does, they won't tear off easy. Okay, that looks like it'll hold together. So then we turn it right side out. All right, there's one paw. Now we'll stuff it full of polyfill up to about this point right here. There, I think that's enough for a good stout limb. All right, there are all 4 legs done. Now I'm going to attach each of these legs to the back of the body. I can tell which one's the back because it's got this little bump here, the frisky little booty, and this is the front. So we'll attach it to the back. Let's see, I'm gonna pin it in place. Get these out of the way. Now at this point I have to decide where on the body I want the legs to go. So, and actually some of these legs turned out shorter than the others. So I have to pick the 2 shortest ones and make them the front limbs. There we go. All right, these two are the shortest. All right, so let's see. Right, that's the neck. That's the shoulder. So I'm thinking I'm going to attach each leg right here, where this little, that slope ends right there and then comes right there. That's a good place for the arms, I think. I'm gonna reinforce these arms. And these arms will be double reinforced once again when I sew the front of the body onto the back, because there'll be another line of stitches going across where the arms attach. All right, those are all four limbs sewn onto Frisky. Now, the tricky part is to sew the front piece onto the back piece, but to do that, these limbs have to be inside like this. Like that, and then so I can get the outside of the fabric sewn onto the correct point. So I'm going to kind of do it section by section. All right, that should be the last leg sewn into place. Now I have to turn everything right side out. And also I have to make sure I pull out my needles. Needle inspection. There. It's like stuffing a turkey. And I can't forget the most important part. Squeaker. The squeaker is the living heartbeat of a stuffed animal toy for a dog. Jack will have fun trying to find it. Whenever he gets a new toy, he will bite all around it to try and find if there's a squeaker. And he gets so happy when there is. When he discovers a squeaker, he's just overjoyed. All right, here is Frisky's body. Done. It's close to what I had drawn on the sketch. Close enough. And now I have to attach her head using a herringbone stitch. And I'll explain what that is. That's a way to sew in that the stitch is hidden within the folds of the material. And what I'm going to make sure I do is make sure I fold over the seam allowance. Grab a piece right there. Like that. Pull it up. And then you fold over the seam allowance here, kind of like fold it in. And then grab a piece from the other side. And then you pull it tight. And it closes that opening and sews it securely. in. You notice how I'm going in from the inside, like this way. On both sides. If you were to actually be able to see the stitch, you would see that it kind of makes like a herringbone pattern, which is why it's called the herringbone stitch. It's a very useful stitch for when you need to mend clothes by hand. And the reason why I'm using like a reddish or burgundy colored thread is because it just so happens to be the thread that was already on the needle. Alright, that should be the last stitch needed. So I'll go ahead and tie it off. There we go. Yeah, so close. Okay, now the only thing left is to attach the nose. So I have my big old bag of pom-poms here. A pom-pom for every occasion. Let's see, let's pull out some contenders. Get one slightly smaller, maybe get a different color. This one right here. I'll clean the fuzz off of it. Maybe that color. Probably nothing smaller than this, I think, just because I made the head so large. Alright. So, let's see what looks the best. We've got that. No, that might be too big. It makes it look like Rudolph. Maybe not that one. We can go a little bit smaller. Black nose, This little brown one, okay, let's pick a spot on this face here, let's go right here. Find that hard spot again. Pull the needle right through. Okay. And we'll put a few more stitches in there to make it secure. Then we'll tie it off right there. Just like that. Got some loose threads coming out. Okay. I'm all done making it. Let's see, here's the squeaker right here. Let me see if I can squeeze it. Yeah, there it is. Okay, now let's give it to Jack and see what he thinks.
Jack, Super Bear? Well, There's something I have to discuss with you. Super Bear, what's that over there? Surprise! Do you like it? Merry Christmas, buddy. Mwah.